The only war we're fighting is a cold one with our old ally turned enemy, the Soviet Union. And we have a national belief in happy endings that is about to change.
October of 62 brought a missile crisis in Cuba, 13 days that shook the world and almost broke it. If you remember it at all, you remember it well. It was a frightening time. That two-week period is our chief port of call tonight, but through much of it, most of us didn't know about it. In early October, not even our young president knew about it for sure, and it seemed that, like him, we were all young and light of heart.
Sherry, Sherry, baby, young is what sells. It is the young who do the twist, ride in convertibles. It is the young who own the space age. Mid-October, America seems to be winning the space race. A 39-year-old Navy pilot becomes the third American to orbit our world. And now, Wally Schirra is back from space, our newest hero of the moment.
Then you saw science coming out of the woodwork. Scientists were no longer considered Van Dyke beards with white smocks. These were regular guys who were exploring things and wanted to know more about man, wanted to know more about medicine.
Another young man, the president's press secretary, Pierre Salinger.
And of course, by 1962, we were getting the first fallback on, we were seeing the results of this space adventure. There was a feeling in the American people as if they were stockholders in this space corporation that we had created, that we were all part of it.
Only a handful of us would go into space, so we brought space down to Earth. Round and around. In October of 1962, the newest space age airport, Dulles, was in the final stages of construction near Washington, D.C. Your reservations would be poured into computers and tickets would come out. You could fly coast to coast on a sleek new 707. In Seattle, where the 1962 World's Fair was in its final week, the big attraction was the Space Needle, and you could glimpse the future as corporate America envisioned it.
This is the Bell System's new touch-tone dialing. With this indicator, you see how many seconds you save the new way.
Let's try it.
Okay, I'll race you. As we look to the future, we see many extras for tomorrow's telephone users. One day, from a public telephone a couple of hundred miles away, turn on your home air conditioner and have the house nice and cool when you return from your hot trip.
Meet George Jetson.
The space age infiltrated comedy and gave us a cartoon sitcom.
Here's Boy Elroy.
And an American playing a Mexican playing an astronaut.
Now your name is?
My name is Iman.
As I understand it, you are the chief astronaut of the United States Interplanetary Expeditionary Force.
I am the chief astronaut of the United States in the plan. My name is Jose Iman.
And space breathed new life into three old knockabout comics.
I was saying, keep your cutting, picking
fingers off the orbit button.
What do you think I am, dumb? I don't think I know.
Well,
I don't think you know either.
No, good night, my someone. Good night.
And yet one of the most popular movies in October 1962 was as earthbound as could be. We checked our preoccupation with space long enough to celebrate the old, rustic, and perhaps mythical virtues of small-town America.
Folks, listen. May I have your attention, please? Attention, please. I can deal with the troubled friends with a wave of my hand, this very hand. Please observe me if you will. I'm Professor Harold Hill, and I'm here to organize a River City Boys band.
A new TV show debuted in the fall of 1962. A family of suddenly rich hillbillies encountered the new technology and was baffled.
This here sideways pump don't work at all. We must have carried in a barrel of water to prime that thing, but it didn't work.
We laughed and made it the top-rated show in the country. Technology even helped us escape technology. The threat of nuclear war was a problem, we were told, that could be solved by concrete, canned goods, and a hole in the ground.
All you need is shelter, a shielding between you and the radioactive fallout.
One of those who told us that was Defense Secretary Robert McNamara.
Not only did anyone believe it, I'd say essentially everybody believed it. And certainly I believed it, the president believed it, I testified in favor of it, I was totally wrong.
Believing comes so easy to us. Don't we have a young president leading us with great vigor into the new frontier? On October 10th, a Gallup poll gives him a startling 62% approval rating. Our love affair with the Kennedys is in full bloom.
There's such a lot of world to see. We're after the same rainbows and waiting round the bend. My huckleberry friend.
But meanwhile, there is no love affair where the 1962 congressional campaign is concerned. Republicans insist Cuba is becoming a Soviet military stronghold and that it's dangerous for Kennedy to continue to ignore it. Max Frankel is covering foreign policy for the New York Times.
There was a big clamor in the Senate led by New York Senator Keating that offensive missiles, possibly even nuclear missiles, were being moved in there, and Kennedy was being forced to deny it and to prove that we were keeping track, and that set the stage for what later happened.
Kennedy is caught by politics. Cuba has become a campaign issue, which is one reason why those things that will soon happen will first happen in secret. A drama of war played to a private audience. Come back to Sunday, October 14th, 1962, for the secret crisis.
Our world continues in a moment. Youth, a time to race with the wind, to run free. That's only a dream for some kids, but you can help them fight to make that dream come true. Every time you buy Budweiser and Bud Light this August, you help us make a contribution to the Muscular Dystrophy Association. So look for this display where you buy Bud and Bud Light. And remember, you really make it work. At Duracell, the race to be the best, to be the king of the road, goes on and on. Which is why today's copper top battery lasts up to 30% longer than the ones we made just 2 years ago. 30% longer. Today's copper top from Duracell. No battery lasts longer.
Mr. Hill, I need to talk to you. Last week, I switched to this Y deodorant, and now I'm getting no protection against wetness.
You need new extra wide Arid protection.
That's wide.
New Arid Extra Wide Solid contains a powerful anti-wetness ingredient these ordinary wide deodorant sticks don't, to fight odor and the wetness they can't.
I'll take extra wide protection. That's Arid protection.
New Extra Wide Arid Solid fights odor and the wetness ordinary wide deodorant sticks can't. Baby Fresh scent, too.
If you think all tartar control toothpastes were created equal, we've got news for you. One of these formulas, Colgate Tartar Control with Fluoride, has been clinically proven more effective. Proven better than Tartar Control Crest at fighting ugly tartar buildup. Over 1.5 times better in a 3-month study, and 4.5 times better in a 6-month study. So once you weigh the evidence, you'll know it's Colgate Tartar Control.
It looks great.
Welcome back to our world. If your newsstand sold Soda Pop in October of 1962, you could buy a Diet Right Cola, the first sugar-free soft drink marketed nationwide. You'd have to go someplace else, though, like a saloon, maybe a package store, to find the first ever pop-top can that was on Iron City beer. Pope John the 23rd convenes Vatican II that month, a council that will perform lasting surgery on the Catholic Church. And the Saturday Evening Post is running a serial version of Failsafe, a new novel about a computer error that launches a nuclear strike on Moscow. The fictional American president is in anguish.
The real American president is not, not yet. At the moment, Kennedy faces only the normal troubles of being president. Kennedy likes to quote this poem to people. Bullfight critics, row on row, crowd the enormous Plaza de Toros. But only one is there who knows, and he is the one who fights the bull. It is Saturday night. Kennedy is about to meet his bull. Only this bull is a bear, a Russian bear.
Never on Sunday does not apply to spies, politicians, and presidents.
As long as you live, Poland lives. Yeshki Polska, Nishki Dewa. That is still true.
On Sunday, October 14th, President Kennedy appears in the Pulaski Day Parade in Buffalo, New York. And in the sky over Cuba, Kennedy has ordered U-2 spy planes to take photographs. The mission is routine. The pictures are not. October 16th, the president summons speechwriter Ted Sorensen.
He told me that Soviet nuclear missiles had been identified on the island of Cuba, 90 miles from our shore, and that a special meeting was being called later that morning of those whom he wanted to consult on the U.S. response.
Kennedy is shocked and angry. But while he and his advisors grope for the appropriate response, it's decided that he will say nothing publicly, that he will adhere to his previously planned schedule as strictly as he can. The man in charge of that is Special Assistant Dave Powers.
The first appointment was the astronaut, Walter Schirra, with his family. And the president, he was so happy. He loved meeting astronauts.
There's a family gathering at the White House as the president receives astronaut Walter M. Schirra, Jr. and his family.
I come into the Oval Room and I see this great man. We'd met him before with Glenn and Shepard. We sat down. I remember my daughter holding up her little grubby fingers. She was 5 years old. The president had asked her, and he's sitting in his rocking chair, smiling very graciously. He's having a good time with us. So it really amazed me when I found out what kind of crisis was really going on all up and down those halls.
At 11:45 that morning, all the president's men, the best and the brightest, gather here in the cabinet room around John Kennedy. They are XCOM, the Executive Committee of the National Security Council. An extraordinary period of crisis management begins in secret. Assistant Secretary of Defense Roswell Gilpatrick.
And I think the sense one got at that first meeting was that, the United States had to move in. We had to do something about it.
At this first meeting, Bobby Kennedy passes his brother a note. I now know how Tojo felt when he was planning Pearl Harbor. The group will continue to meet, its existence and concerns still secret.
It's D-Day at Candlestick. 6 months of baseball now spirals to a climax in just one game.
The only missile of concern that day to the American people was a horsehide rocket launched by Willie McCovey and intercepted by Bobby Richardson in the bottom of the ninth. And instead of the Giants beating the Yankees in the seventh game of the World Series, it was the other way around. At that moment, I was appearing in a play here in Paramus, New Jersey, at a theater run by Robert Ludlum. He went on to write thriller novels with somewhat greater success. The theater's closed now. It was back there in that mall somewhere. I don't remember the play, but I do remember listening to that World Series game backstage and grieving for Willie McCovey. Cuba was a long way away.
Congressional elections are only 3 weeks away. Wednesday, October 17th. Kennedy goes to Connecticut to campaign for Democratic candidates. And in California, an ex-president is campaigning for an ex-vice president, Richard Nixon, who's running for governor.
I'm for Nixon!
I'm for Nixon, too.
California needs him.
Meanwhile, in Washington, the XCOM is meeting. The latest reconnaissance photos show that the missiles could be operational within a week. With the president gone, the discussion is heated, and the advisors divide into two camps.
Bobby Kennedy, McNamara, and I were the only ones who wanted to keep the military response at its lowest level. Everybody else wanted an airstrike or the Joint Chiefs of Staff ultimately wanted just to go in and, you know, clean out the Castro regime.
Dean Acheson, the former Secretary of State, was called in as an outside consultant. He recommended an airstrike against the missiles in Cuba. Someone said to him, "Mr. Secretary, what will the Soviets do in response?" "Oh, I know the Soviets pretty well," he said, "from dealing with them over the years. I think they will then feel obligated to launch an attack and knock out our missiles in Turkey. And what will we then do, Mr. Secretary?" "Well," he said, "under the NATO treaty, we would then be obligated to knock out Soviet missile sites inside the Soviet Union." "Well, what will they then do, Mr. Secretary?" "Well," he said, "we hope by that time cooler heads will prevail and everybody will talk." Fortunately, we did not take his advice.
And during these long days when the president and his men are trying to decide whether or not we go to war, the cover must be kept. So Bobby Kennedy takes time from the crisis to attend the premiere of the big movie that fall, The Longest Day. It is an epic about war.
Also für die Alliierten, aber auch für die Deutschen. Der längste Tag wird. Der längste Tag.
Come on, move up!
Thursday, October 18th. The XCOM looks at reports showing that the missiles in Cuba could carry half the Soviet Union's warheads and carry them right to us. Kennedy keeps a previously scheduled appointment to meet Soviet Foreign Minister Andrei Gromyko.
The president asked a direct question to Gromyko, said, "Is it true that you're installing missiles in Cuba?" Gromyko said, "Absolutely not." Just flatly lied to the president. And which was interesting because also it did not reveal to Gromyko that we knew that the missiles existed.
As fortune would have it, the same day technology is threatening to blow us from the face of the Earth, technology is pushing the space race forward. The Ranger 5 moon probe is launched from Cape Canaveral. And the beginnings of life are honored when an American and a British scientist, Watson and Crick, take the Nobel Prize for discovering the key to genetics, DNA. And if you're watching ABC on that Thursday night, you see
Ozzy, Harriet, David, and Ricky.
At 7:30, a happy family of four. At 8, another happy family of four. And at 8:30, a very happy family of four. Life is pretty simple here, but this is television, not reality.
And Jerry Mathers as the Beaver.
Beaver is kind of the innocent, viewing the world, not really understanding it. Wally is the middle character. He's kind of the bridge between the adult world and Beaver's innocent world. And then there's the adult saying, you know, this is what should be done. Sometimes they don't even do what they say, but they still say this is the way it should be done.
What has to be done in the adult world of Washington is to keep the Cuban crisis secret.
There were all kinds of cover stories to explain everything, even by somebody as high as McGeorge Bundy, who is the national security advisor, urging us to believe that it was yet another Berlin crisis. Yes, we are having trouble. There's something in Berlin. We don't want to talk about it. We think we can get through it, but it's tough. About 12 o'clock, I called up the German ambassador, a fellow named Graver, and it was very clear that I got him out of bed about 11:30. And the lights were burning in the State Department, the lights were burning at the White House. Of an alleged Berlin crisis, and the German ambassador is calmly asleep. I came back to the office. I said, you know, not Berlin.
Friday, October 19th.
Friday was a tough day. He spoke in Cleveland, tremendous crowds, and he spoke at, he visited Lincoln's tomb. And then we came into Chicago, and Daley and all the crowd.
That night, Bobby Kennedy calls his brother in Chicago, asking him to return to the White House and the crisis. Saturday, October 20th.
I'm having breakfast with the president. He called Admiral Berkeley, the White House physician, down to his suite. And about 10 minutes later, he called Pierre.
And I arrived in the suite, and the president was sitting there in his bathrobe, and he had this yellow pad in front of him, and he was writing on it. And he hands me the pad, and the pad said 99.2 degrees temperature. Doctor says president must return to Washington for treatment. And he said, I want you to call a press conference and announce that because we're flying back to Washington. The president came out of the hotel with an overcoat and a hat on. I mean, he never wore a hat. And, you know, kind of bundled up. And I think if you saw him from outside, you had the impression that he maybe did have the flu.
The president goes immediately to the White House. Secretary of State Dean Rusk is there.
And when he walked into the room to join the rest of us, he looked around the table and said with a little smile, well, gentlemen, today we're going to earn our pay. He decided, on the recommendation of myself and Bob McNamara, Bobby Kennedy, and some others, to use the quarantined method to blockade offensive weapons coming into Cuba.
An armada of U.S. naval ships would form a blockade line 500 miles from Cuba. Soviet bloc ships trying to cross the line would be stopped and searched for missile parts. On land that weekend, the military also is on the move. In Key West, Florida, a command post for a possible invasion of Cuba is being set up. Monroe County Commissioner Billy Freeman gets a late-night phone call.
The government wanted permission to build an observation tower at this airport. And I had to call the lumber yard and get them to open up to be able to get the materials out to come out here and build this thing. And I must admit, it was about the fastest piece of construction I've ever seen done. And that was the first inkling that something was going on.
Most of us have no inkling that anything is afoot.
With the title, Mr. President, you wondered, no doubt, just who it could be. Don't jump to conclusions. It's not
on Broadway, a new Irving Berlin musical opens about a mythical White House, a mythical president, Robert Ryan, and a mythical First Lady, Nanette Fabre.
Not the Kennedys.
One of the songs is not all that mythical.
If you make the wrong decision when the final chips are down, the White House is the loneliest place in town.
Sunday, October 21st, the missile secret is now a week old.
Don't take your love away from me.
The Seattle World's Fair ends a successful run. President Kennedy pleading that phony cold does not attend closing ceremonies. Ranger 5, the unmanned moon probe, misses its target by more than 300 miles. And the troop movements are increasing now. The media are beginning to sniff out the big story.
And for us, it was vital that the story not break until the American fleet was in position to exercise the blockade that we were setting up around Cuba.
Max Frankel of the Times and his boss James Reston call Salinger and tell him they have the story. The president calls back.
And within minutes, President Kennedy was on the phone and said something on the order of, so you know what it is. Reston said, yes, we do. You found offensive missiles in Cuba. Kennedy said, do you know what I'm going to do about it? He said, no, we can't find out. He said, well, I'm going to put on a blockade. Just like that, gave us the story. He said, now you can't print that. And as a matter of fact, I don't want you to print that we know they got nuclear missiles there. If you tip off the Russians in advance as to what I'm going to do or the fact that this is what we're acting on, they may take measures to try to rush some ships in there. Or to put the nuclear warheads on the missiles. So it's up to you as to whether we get into a war, and I'm asking you not to print the story.
The Times agrees to sit on the story. But first, the president must assure Frankel and Reston that he's not buying time to mount some kind of secret action against Cuba.
And the president said, I understand and I appreciate it, and you have my word of honor, that there will be no violence and no war until, I hope, ever, but certainly not before I go on the air tomorrow night and tell the country what this is all about. And I'd be grateful for your cooperation. And Reston said, okay, you have it.
Come back to Monday, October 22nd, and the end of blissful ignorance. President Kennedy tells the American people what's going on in Cuba, and the fear begins.
It's man against machine at the Silver Bullet.
Lou, what is this thing?
Oh, it's our new punching machine.
Watch it.
Put your money in here. Light goes on.
Wham!
Tells you how hard you punch.
Come back when you're a man.
Hey, Carlos Palomino, you're a world champion. Give it a shot.
Here, hold my course lights.
What does it say? No mas, no mas.
There's no slowing down with the Silver Bullet tonight.
With this job, I need the strength of a man's antiperspirant, Speed Stick.
Today, there's Lady Speed Stick antiperspirant with the most powerful wetness fighter available. Speed Stick protection made for women, so it's gentle.
I'd love a woman's antiperspirant that could keep me dry all day.
Lady Speed Stick glides on dry. Nothing fights wetness and odor better.
With my active schedule, delicate antiperspirants aren't enough.
Lady Speed Stick protects you like a man.
And treats you like a woman.
Lady Speed Stick.
Amen.
New improved Whisk. It's not just for collars.
It's for dirty skirts, filthy shirts, dusty socks, spattered smocks, messy tees, dungarees.
New improved Whisk. It gets out ring around the collar and gets your whole wash cleaner than ever. So?
For shorts so bright, tops this white, cleaner best, Sunday best, and all the rest.
New Whisk. For ring around the collar and a cleaner wash.
When a stomach balks, Davy Johnson reaches for serious medicine. Rolaids consumes all the acid required to bring millions 100% relief. And relief is needed on days like these.
I should have gone into golf.
Get serious relief. Get Rolaids.
Schick Disposable has an improved blade angle to shave you closer for the easy touch.
In a moment, our world continues, recalling the way we were, 13 days in October, 1962.
Saturday, the fun tees off with a PGA Classic. Top pros compete at the oldest event on the tour. Live, it's the Beatrice Western Open. Then on ABC's Wide World of Sports, it's a live championship bout. Undefeated Mark Breland defends his welterweight crown against the top-ranked challenger, Marlon Starling. Plus, they've won two races against each other. Now Ali Sheba meets rival Bet Twice once again at the Travers Stakes live. Everybody's having fun Saturday.
ABC Sports, reaching new heights.
Sandstone Home Center's below-cost sale. Hundreds of items marked down below our actual cost. Our warehouse is overstocked and our accountants have told us sell it. Get rid of it. 50-foot hose, below cost. Ortho snail killer, below cost. Lawn sprinkler, below cost. Romex electrical wire, below cost. Many other items throughout our gigantic store priced below our cost, which means big savings to you. No dealers, please. Quantities are limited, so hurry on down to Sandstone Home Center now.
At Nissan of Bakersfield, you're number one.
That's right. You're the most important part of our business.
So we're here to make you happy every day.
At Nissan of Bakersfield, you get a great selection of quality Nissan cars and trucks.
And you get a great deal.
We never forget that you're number one.
If you want a great deal on a new Nissan, come see us.
Come to Nissan of Bakersfield in the Bakersfield Auto Mall south of White Lane off Weibel.
Local immigration officials are working overtime tonight on Night Beat.